Yes, you're so worthy, God. Oh, 1,000 tongues to say the glories of our Lord God Almighty. Oh, to sing the Savior's praise, the triumph of His grace. You are worthy. You are worthy, God.
Good morning, church. You can take a seat. Woo! Oh, man, it's good. Church, does it look different on the stage? Only five people noticed. Church, does it look different on the stage? I got to say a huge shout out to Kurt and Dan who got this happening. Huge shout out to them. Let's give them a round of applause. They deserve it. They put in so much time and effort. But go to the real reason. I want to welcome you, as it says on the screens, the Barrington Ridge Baptist Church. We're so glad you're here. We're so glad that you can worship with us, celebrate the true King and Lord of all. And we just want to prepare our hearts as we go into this time of worship. So we're going to bow our heads and just give thanks. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for this awesome opportunity where we can just worship you. I pray over this time that we put aside anything that's going on in our lives and we ready our hearts to hear from you, God. And that we ready our hearts, that we leave here changed, and that we just don't go to lunch after and forget about the whole sermon, but we leave here changed to create an impact in the world and an impact for you, God. I pray over this time of worship that we put aside our differences and we just open up and stretch our hand out to the one and only Savior. And I ask this in your name we pray. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth. Thank you.
To you are. Nolan talked about changes on the stage here and the work that we put in yesterday. You noticed I moved a little slower today. You like to kill this yesterday, but it's because of what we're about to do is the only reason that we're able to accomplish these things up here. It's faithful givers and tithers who make all of this possible. Tithing is an act of worship. We simply return to God a portion of what he's blessed us with. So as we enter this time of the service, be generous. Worship God with your tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the morning, for the time that we're here, for the privilege to gather and worship you. We thank you for this part of the service where we can return a portion to you of what you've blessed us with. You've blessed us so bountifully. Father, help us to worship you in spirit and in truth as we do this part of the service. And Father, I pray for the rest of the service that you would be glorified and honored in all that we say and do. In Jesus' name, amen.
From heaven's throne, you came to us and set your heart upon the cross. We'll never know the sacrifice you made. Lord, Christ exalted over all. Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean.
Sing that again.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. And my sorrows, he made them his very own, and he bore the burden to Calvary, and suffered and died alone, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. And with a ransomed in glory, his face I last shall see, will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Thank you for your marvelous love that you poured out on Calvary for us all. We thank you, God, that you allow us to come into your presence this morning and sing praises to you. It's all because of you that we can be here, Lord. We pray, God, that you would help us to put aside any distractions that we may have right now, that we would tune in to what you have for us this morning, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, yes, it is. It is now. It's good to be with you this morning. I've got some echo up here. My name is Wes Rankin. I am a member at Barrington Ridge Baptist Church, and that may come as a surprise to some of you because you don't see me very often. And some of you said, that's okay as long as your wife comes. And maybe the reason you don't see me very often is I'm also the director of missions for the association. So most Sundays I'm somewhere else at another church. But it's always good to be back with my home church and love this church and love. What I love about Barrington Ridge is that Barrington Ridge is just not about Barrington Ridge. Barrington Ridge is about the kingdom. And that's in your DNA. You know, you've always been about outside of yourselves, outside of even your own churches, with other churches, the kingdom. And that's the way we all ought to be, individually and corporately. It's not about us. It's not just about building our kingdom, our church. It's about building the kingdom. And so much of what Barrington Ridge's history has been that. It's been about kingdom building. And so just appreciate your love for the kingdom, your love for our association of churches, your help for some of our other churches. Danilo Rodriguez is here today, who is the Hispanic church planter for our Hispanic work in Whiting. You are the sponsoring sending church for his work. And so there's so much that you do that we need to rejoice in. And I thank you so much as a director of missions for this church's participation. I just got a text just a few moments ago from JJ. He said he's praying for me today. And this is what I sent back to him, just to let him know. I said, got a great message on the benefit of speaking in tongues today for your people. I said, your people will love it. And I just want to mess up the rest of his vacation. I really don't have that message for you, but I'm sure he is speeding down the interstate at this moment, trying to get back. Brian, have you got a call from him to come and take me off stage or anything like that yet? Okay. So I just wanted to, I'm sure he knows I'm joking. I do want to thank you. As some of you probably know, Paula's mother passed away a couple weeks ago, and I know many of you all have been praying for her and praying. I would ask you to continue to pray for her, continue to pray for her father, who is now experiencing life after, gosh, so many years of being married without her. And so continue to pray for them. We do appreciate your prayers, though, in that. If you would this morning, I would ask you to turn to Psalms chapter 110. Psalms 110. On Wednesday nights, Kurt and I have been teaching, Kurt more than me, but been teaching through different Psalms. We're calling it kind of a summer of Psalms on Wednesday night. And I want to bring that theme here to Sunday morning, and I'd like for us to look at Psalm 110. It's one of the most quoted psalms in the New Testament. In fact, it is referenced at least 14 times in the New Testament, and when it's referenced, it's always applied to our King and our Redeemer, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so this is what we call a messianic psalm. So it's going to be I know it scares Baptists when we talk about this, but it's going to be more of a doctrinal sermon this morning. It's going to be more of a theological sermon this morning, but it's going to have application to it. So it's going to be relevant to our lives. And so it's going to be more of doctrinal, especially in regards to the great three themes that are laid out in this psalm. The three themes of how this psalm is divided up are this: Christ as King, Christ as Priest, and Christ as Warrior. And so we're going to look at those three themes. So let's begin reading in verse 1 of chapter 110 of the book of Psalms. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. Verse 4. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter the kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among nations, filling them with corpses. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as your word says, all scripture is given by inspiration, and it is profitable, you say, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that every man, every woman, every boy, every girl will be equipped for every good work. And so now we ask, and we know, Lord, that every word of Scripture is profitable, and every word of Scripture is needful, and every word of Scripture is your word, Lord. It is your word. And so we ask that you would cause your word this morning to be both needful and profitable to our hearts. And Lord, help us by your grace to give attention to it, Lord. Lord, give us ears to hear. By the Holy Spirit, Lord, help us heed the things that we hear this morning and obey. And we pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. So this is not your normal kind of director of missions sermon. You know, normally director of missions comes into church and we're going to talk about missions. We're going to talk about outreach. We're going to talk about being on mission with God. We're going to talk about maybe the vision of the association. But this is more, again, it's more of a doctrinal sermon, kind of going along with the themes that you've been talking about over the last several weeks. But this is a Psalm of David. That is, David wrote the psalm. It's not a psalm about David. It's not a psalm. It's not a psalm about him. In fact, Jesus himself said that David was the writer of this psalm over in Luke chapter 20. David was writing this psalm about someone who was the greater king, someone who was the greater Lord, the Messiah of God, the Christ. That's who he's writing this psalm about. So as we work our way through this psalm this morning, we're going to use that outline that Christ as king, Christ as priest, and Christ as warrior. And we're going to give some time to contemplate what it means, what this means for us this morning. First of all, I want you to see, want us to see Christ as king. Again, in verses 1 through 3, it says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours." So notice first who this king is. Notice first who he is. The psalm says, the psalm of David begins, David says, with a declaration, "The Lord said to my Lord." The Lord says to my Lord. Now, in most of your English translations, that first Lord there is in all capital letters. And when you see that in our English translations, in all capital letters, they're doing that because the Hebrew behind that is the name of the God of Israel. The Hebrew name behind that English word for Lord, all in capital letters, is the word, the Hebrew word, Yahweh, or Jehovah. And then, literally, what it says in verse 1, the Lord, that is the God of Israel, Yahweh, Jehovah, said to my Lord. David is saying, Yahweh said to my Lord. Well, the question is, who's David's Lord? Who's David's Lord? David is saying that the God of Israel is saying something to his Lord, but who is David referring to here? Well, to get some further clarification on that, let's look at Luke chapter 20, verses 41 through 44. Now, the context here is this is after the scribes have questioned Jesus, and Jesus answered them so impressively that even they have to admit that his answer was correct. And so Jesus turns the table on them, and he asked them, he says to them, in verse 41, he said to them, how can you say that the Christ is David's son? How can you say that the Christ is David's son? Then he quotes Psalm 110. For David himself says in the book of Psalms, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. David, and then it goes on to say, David thus calls him Lord. Jesus says, David just thus calls him Lord. So how is he his son? Now in Hebrew thought, the Father is always greater than the Son. And here David is talking about Messiah, his descendant, as being greater than him. David's saying, my son is greater than me. My descendant is greater than me. And Jesus is posing the question to the scribes, how would you explain that exactly? So what Jesus is saying here is that Messiah is more. Listen, here's the point. Messiah is more than just human. He is, in fact, David's Lord. This descendant is David's Lord. In other words, the psalmist is pointing to the fact of the deity of Christ, that David's Lord is none other than the second person of the Trinity. Jesus Christ the Lord. The first person of the Trinity said to the second person of the Trinity, that's what's going on here. The Lord, Jehovah, said to my Lord, the Messiah, the Son of God, Christ the Son, the second person of the Trinity. So his identity is clear. We're talking about Christ as King, that he is deity, that he is God. But notice also here, as we're talking about Christ the King, notice his position. He said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Yahweh says to Christ the King, sit at my right hand. Jesus the King, the Messiah, is sitting at the right hand of God the Father right now. Now, in Christian theology, we talk a lot about the crucifixion, obviously. We talk a lot about the resurrection. We even talk a lot about the ascension of Christ. But we don't talk about this fourth aspect. It's called the session of Christ. Ever heard of that? The session of Christ. His session. Some of you who may have come from different types of churches, different kinds of backgrounds, know or study some church history, know something called the Apostles' Creed. We Baptists don't like creeds. I wish we liked them a little bit more because there's really some really good theology in creeds, ancient creeds. But the Apostles' Creed is a wonderful document of church history. But part of the Apostles' Creed says this. You may have heard it. It says, on the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. And what? He sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. This sitting at the right hand of God is called heavenly session. It's called the heavenly session. When the legislature, we talk about the legislature being in session. What we mean by that is that they are ruling, they're governing, that they're exercising authority, they're giving leadership. So Jesus, the King, is right now, this moment, in session. That is, he is sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's sitting there not to rest, folks. He's there to rule. So Jesus is sitting, not to rest, but to exercise authority to rule over this world by his word and by his spirit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. So we see here that God the Father has set the Messiah at his right hand as king to see all enemies under his feet. He rules as king from heaven over all spheres of authority that exists, over all humans, over all angels, over all demons, over all existence. He rules over that. And he also rules over his church. And as king, ruling actively from heaven, every human being will have to give account to him. And his session in heaven will continue until all his enemies, including death, are brought to nothing. Paul talks about that in that familiar passage in Philippians chapter 2. You remember this. And it says, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Now, what is that? That's his crucifixion, right? Therefore, God has highly exalted him. What is that? That's his resurrection, his ascension, and his session. He has highly exalted him and bestowed on him a name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So his session in heaven means that all will have to give an account to him. And once death has been ultimately defeated and judgment has been ultimately executed, then, listen, his session will end. His session will end. And he will triumphantly deliver the kingdom to his Father. And the question for every one of us here this morning is, are you part of that kingdom? Are you part of that kingdom that Jesus Christ will deliver after his sin is over, after his enemies have been defeated? Are you part of that kingdom he will deliver over to his Father? But also, we see here, as we're talking about Christ as king, regarding his kingship, we also see that not only there's his person, that he's the deity, not only that he is, but that thirdly, that his program, what is he doing? What is he doing as Christ is king? In verse 2 and 3 tells us that. It says, the Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning to the dew of your youth will be yours. Now, real quickly here, there are two aspects that of his program as Christ is king that are mentioned here. First of all, he's ruling over his enemies. He's ruling over his enemies. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter, rule in the midst of your enemies. That is, as I've already mentioned, Jesus' enemies are going to be forcefully subdued. His enemies are going to be forcefully subdued. They will have to acknowledge his rule. They will. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Those in heaven, those on earth, those under the earth. Everyone will have to acknowledge his rule. He will rule over his enemies. But also, he's going to rule over his friends. I love this. He says, your people will offer themselves freely on that day of your power in holy garments. In other words, his people will willingly embrace his reign. They will willingly love his reign. His reign is their freedom. His reign is their glory. His reign is their hope. Those who really want to rule their own lives, those who really want to keep Jesus at a distance, those who have Jesus as an emotional, sentimental add-on to their lives, or those who have Jesus as this cultural icon like so many people in our culture have him, or those have Jesus only as a ticket to get into heaven, really don't embrace his reign. They don't embrace his rule. And in fact, you have to question, do they really love Jesus? Do they really have him as their Lord? Do they really belong to him? And so he is king. This psalm tells us Christ as king in his position and in his program and in his person. He is king. Secondly, real quickly, we see here also that Christ is priest. Notice what it says in verse 4. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now, here we have this second oracle from the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, the Lord Yahweh, the second oracle from the Lord. But it's not only an oracle, it is an oath. It's an oath. He is not only announcing his word, but he's swearing an oath. Who's he swearing an oath to? He's swearing an oath to Messiah, the second person of the Trinity. And here's that oath. He says, you are a priest forever. But then he says something very odd, after the order of Melchizedek. Now, who in the world is Melchizedek? Not many of our kids do we name Melchizedek. You know, it's just a strange name. His name is mentioned only one other time in the Old Testament, and that's in the book of Genesis. And if you remember the story in the book of Genesis, there's this kind of weird, obscure scene where Abraham has defeated the enemy. He's rescued his nephew Lot. And this guy shows up out of nowhere. He just kind of appears. And he shows up with bread and wine. He shows up to give to Abraham, to honor Abraham, bread and wine. And Abraham honors this mysterious person by giving him a tenth of all the spoil that he has won in his victory over his enemies. This person's name is Melchizedek. He just appears. And you get over into the New Testament in the book of Hebrews, then Melchizedek appears over and over again as the writer of Hebrews explains and applies this psalm and the story in Genesis to who? He applies this story and this psalm to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Almighty God is saying of the Messiah, you are not only, here's the point, you are not only a king, but you are a priest, but you're not just any priest, you're a priest of the order of Melchizedek. You say, well, what's important about being a priest after the order of Melchizedek? What's the importance of that? Well, you've got to remember that the king of Israel could not be priest. By the law of Moses, the kingship and the priesthood, the kingship and the priesthood could not be combined. They could not be mixed together. They had to stay separate. It's kind of like the executive branch and the legislative branch of the U.S. government. They could not be mixed. King and priest could not be brought together. They had to stay separate. And one of the reasons Saul lost his kingship is because he attempted to perform the duties of a priest. So the king could not be a priest according to the order of Aaron or according to the order of Levi. The king could not be priest. But here it says that Messiah, the king, is a priest. According to, not the order of Aaron, not the order of Levi, but to the order of Melchizedek. If you study about Melchizedek, we see that he has no lineage that we know of. It doesn't tell us about any heritage, any descendants. none of them are given to us. And he appears to Abraham, listen, he appears to Abraham as both king of Salem and priest of the Most High God. Melchizedek was king and priest, and our Messiah comes to us after the order of Melchizedek, both as king and as priest. And so because of his priesthood, because it's like that of Melchizedek, he is able to be both king and priest. And you say, okay, all right, that sounds like really good theology, good doctrine, but what in the world does that mean to me in my everyday life? How does that apply to me where I'm at? Well, what does a priest do? That's the question. What does a priest do? And in the Old Testament, there were several functions of the Old Testament priest that Christ himself has fulfilled. One of those is he offers himself as a perfect sacrifice for sin. In the Old Testament priest, the Old Testament priest could only offer the blood of animals such as bulls and goats for sin. And that was never sufficient, the Bible says, to cover our sin. For example, the Bible says, for it was impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. But instead, Jesus offered himself up as the perfect sacrifice. In Hebrews 9:26, it says, but as it is, he has appeared once and for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. So Jesus served both as the sacrifice and the priest who offered a sacrifice. You see the beauty of that? He was a sacrifice, but he's also the priest that offered a sacrifice. And the sacrifice was himself. He offered his own self, his own body, his own life, his own blood to appease the wrath of God the Father, of Yahweh God, against the just penalty of our sin. That's what he did. That's how it applies to us. So Jesus is the lamb that was slain. He lays down his own life. He sheds his own blood for my sin, thereby appeasing the wrath of God and taking away my sin and making peace between me and God. Hallelujah. He is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. But also, not only did the Old Testament priests provide a sacrifice for sin, but the second thing we see from the Old Testament priest is that they were to sympathize with us and our hurt. That's what Jesus does. He sympathizes with us in our hurt. Again, Hebrews says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us in our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we have been, yet without sin. What that means is that as priest, Jesus in his deity comes to represent God to men, but listen, in his humanity, he comes to represent man to God. He comes to identify with us. And so since he became one of us, he is now able to, from his position as ascended high priest, he is able to sympathize with us in our hurts and our pains and our weaknesses and our confusions, with our sicknesses. He is a merciful high priest. So what does that mean? That means that there is nothing in life that you have gone through, nothing in life that you will go through, that Jesus in some way has not gone through himself yet without sin. So in a very real way, Jesus really knows how we feel. He knows our pain. We used to have a president that said he felt our pain. But he could not, nor could any of us, really feel pain in the same way that Jesus feels our pain. Not in the fullest sense. Why? Because no one person has gone through everything that we have gone through or will go through and come out victoriously as Jesus has. We took a vacation a couple weeks ago now. I can't even keep up track of time anymore. But we went out west, and so one of the things we did while we were there is visit the Grand Canyon. And I had on my bucket list to hike the Grand down to the bottom of the Grand Canyon and hike back up. And so they suggest that you don't do that in one day, and I did it in one day. And they really suggest that you don't do it in one day during the summer, because the Grand Canyon gets extremely hot at the bottom during the summer. It gets up around 120 degrees. And so, you know, they're talking about all these horror stories of people who have died and people who have, you know, dehydrated and actually literally died at the bottom. And of course, Paula and the girls are there. They didn't hike with me. I wouldn't allow them, but they're giving me all these warnings, and I'm telling them it's going to be okay. It's a fear. You know, they're just trying to throw all these fear things to keep people from doing it. But, you know, I thought I was in pretty good shape, and I was. And so I hiked this thing. It's about 17.3 miles down and back up. And down was wonderful. I started about 5 o'clock in the morning and hiked and ran, and I was down in about 2 hours and 30 minutes. Down at there's a place down there where people camp and cabins down there. So I get down there 2 hours and 30 minutes, 2 hours and 45 minutes, thinking this is going to be a breeze. I'm going to get up so quickly that I'm going to really shock Paula and the girls, because they're afraid I'm not even going to make it back. And so all this. And so I rest for about 45 minutes to an hour down there. And so I start my way back. And the first couple miles on the way back, I'm still feeling pretty good. But mile three, and you got to remember, the sun, there's no shade. You're down in that canyon. You're climbing up these switchbacks. And the sun's just on you all the time. And about 3 miles into it, I started slowing down a little bit. And noticed, man, I'm a lot more thirsty than I've ever been before. And in about 4 or 5 miles into it, I think, I don't know if I'm going to be able to make this or not. And I'm looking up, and you got to remember, you're down, you're 5,000 feet. You descend 5,000 feet, you're climbing back up 5,000 feet. And all you can see as you're climbing back is this huge canyon, you know, that you just look up there and you say, there's just no way. This is an obstacle that's way greater than I can ever accomplish. And so I, at some point, I just had to mentally kick it into gear and say, I've got to get out of here. And I made it. I made it. But I made it with a great deal of humility, and it really humbled me. But I say all that to say this. That obstacle seemed insurmountable to me at one point. And I was able to, in my own human flesh and own strength and conditioning, able to be victorious in that, in a sense. But what I'm saying to you is that in life, the kind of things that come at us every day are much greater than hiking down and out of the Great Grand Canyon. The losses that we experience, the pains that we experience, the struggles that we go through are insurmountable to us in our own flesh. But I want to tell you, we have someone who has gone through everything that we have gone through, and is at the right hand of the Father in session, who is our sympathetic high priest. And the last thing that he says here is, not only is he there to sympathize with us, but he prays for us in our need. Another role he plays for us as priests is that he intercedes for us. Again, the writer of Hebrews says, consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. You hear that? He always lives to make intercession for them. Not only in his high priestly ministry did Jesus serve me through his death by offering himself up as an acceptable sacrifice, But he also serves me now because he arose from the grave. He ascended into heaven. He is alive and well today, and he continues to function. Listen, he continues to function in his priestly office as my living intercessor. What that means is that Jesus is he's paying attention to me. And he's paying attention to me not because I'm a great guy, because I'm not. He's paying attention to me because he's a great God. He's paying attention to you. If you belong to him, he's paying attention to you. Jesus knows every hair on our head, and for some of us, that's no big deal. But he knows everything about us. He knows every day of our life. He knows our desires and longings. He knows our fears, our thoughts. And so Jesus didn't just go to heaven and abandon us. He is paying very careful attention to our lives and doing what? He's interceding for us. And so in a very real sense, he's bringing our needs before Yahweh. He's bringing our needs before the Father. He's saying they're hurting or they're struggling or they're tempted or they're drifting or they're discouraged or they're frightened, whatever it may be. And I want you to know he's a priest unlike any other priest. He's a perfect priest. And as a perfect priest, you know what his prayers are? His prayers are always heard. His prayers are always effectual. How do you know that? Listen to this verse, Hebrews 5:8. With loud cries, he interceded for us, and he was heard because of his piety. He was heard because of his piety. God the Father has to hear the prayers of Christ, the Messiah, King, Priest, because of his perfect piety. That could not be said of me. That could not be said of any other priest. That could not be said of any other Christian, that we have perfect piety, or that God has to hear our prayers, or God has to answer our prayers, because sometimes our prayers are interfered by our own sin, but not with Christ. His prayers are always, without exception, heard and effectual. And that's great comfort. So this psalm not only reveals that Christ is king, but that he is priest. And you know what that does? That makes Christianity, listen, that makes Christianity extremely different than any religion in the world. Why is that? Because we have a God that gets off his throne as king and humbles himself and comes down into human history and humbly serves you, walks with you, saves you, gives you grace and mercy and praise for you as a merciful high priest. No other religion in the world even comes close to that. Lastly and quickly, Psalm not only shows Christ as Messiah, Christ the Messiah as king and priest, but lastly here, I want you to see this as we close with this. Sees him as Christ as warrior. Look at verses 5 through 7. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpses. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head. Now, people think of Jesus in a lot of different ways. In the church and in our culture, most see him as kind of the meek and mild and gentle Jesus, kind of the gentle, you know, meek and mild lamb caricature that we kind of make of Jesus. Or some see him kind of as the serene, skinny, hippie kind of Jesus. You know, that kind of Jesus who, you know, is, you know, always talking about peace and love and rides around in the VW van. That Jesus. We kind of love that Jesus. We love the meek and mild Jesus. We love the gentle Jesus. And he is meek and mild and he is gentle. I don't know about the part, but he is meek and mild and gentle. But to see him only in this way is not to see him. To see him in this way as we see here in the psalm, as the warrior king making war against his enemies and bringing judgment, this is not what most people think about when they think about Jesus, if they think about him at all. But this is our Jesus. And to deny him as warrior is to deny him altogether. To deny that he is going to execute judgment. To deny that he is going to relentlessly and thoroughly pour out his wrath in an act of war against the kings, against the chiefs, against the nations, is to have a Jesus of our own imagination, who is not Jesus at all, just an idol that we have created. And I would say that the Jesus that most people worship in the world is not the Jesus of Scripture. It's a Jesus of their own imagination. It's an idolic Jesus. Principally, what I think this passage is talking about, I think about it, is talking about his second coming. Remember what it says in Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16? It says, "Then I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and one sitting on it called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written that no one knows but himself. And he is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses." Notice, "From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which he will strike down the nations. And he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." That's Jesus. That's another aspect to who he is. It's not just the Lamb of God coming to seek and save that which is lost, which he does, but it's also the line of Judah coming to seek and destroy that which is lost. He is a warrior sent from the Father to execute judgment on the earth. Now, I want to bring this down practically to us as we close with this. There's another aspect, in another sense, that Jesus will not only wear his warrior cap when he comes back at the end of history, he is right now wearing his warrior cap, okay? Right now he's wearing his warrior cap. He is the head of the church. He is the chief warrior over the church. And he's the warrior, a chief warrior over the church so that we, listen, so that we can be the church militant. You say, "I don't like that word militant." Well, that's who we are. That's who we are supposed to be. Now, what I mean by that is this. He is warrior for his people. Now, we know this verse in the New Testament where Jesus says, "I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Now, when we hear that verse, most people think of it this way, that the church is on a defensive posture, that hell is on the attack, and that hell will not be able to prevail against the gates that we set up, basically. And that we'll be able to withstand the assaults of the devil and his minions. And they think that way because we look at that word prevail, and it sounds like hell is on the attack. But that is not what Jesus is saying in his text. He says the gates of hell will not prevail. The gates of hell will not prevail. And it sounds like hell's on the attack, but this is not talking about an army of hell unleashed from its gates. It's not what it's talking about. It's talking about a gate of a fortress. And gates and fortresses do what? They don't move. Gates don't move. They don't prevail. They don't go forward. Fortresses don't move. And so they are defensive structures. So the picture that Jesus is presenting is not hell on the march and God's people putting up and held up in a fortress in a defensive posture trying to hold on to the end. We just got to hold on to the end. That's not the posture of the church. The picture here is a picture of Jesus and his church on the march. And even the gates of hell cannot hold us back. And so the question that we got to ask ourselves, are we going to be the militant church or are we going to be the milquetoast church? Or are we going to be militant Christians and a militant in a good sense? I mean, not with arms. Not with grenades. We got a weapon. It's called the gospel. That's our weapon. Are we going to be the militant church? Are we going to be the milquetoast church? Are we going to be a church, a collection of God's people on march with our warrior king, taking territory from the enemy one soul at a time? There's a hymn. We're out of time, and I won't. There's a great hymn, and I won't, because it's like a time, I won't repeat it. But basically, the hymn talks about we are to be on mission with our great warrior king, infiltrating the world, infiltrating our culture, on mission with our great weapon, and our great weapon is the gospel of Jesus Christ. A church that is following the warrior king is not consumed with internal matters. It's not cowering in this corner hoping that they can hold up against the spiritual and cultural attacks that are coming their way. No, a church of the warrior king is focused outward. They are marching forward on attack against the enemy. And they're using their most powerful weapon, the gospel of Jesus Christ. God, help us be those kind of Christians. God, help us be that kind of church. As we close, get ready to close an invitation, just three questions I would have for you as kind of a way of application, reflection. First of all, have you submitted to Him? Have you submitted your life to Him as King? He is King. But for some in our churches, Jesus is kind of like a sentimental add-on to their lives. Or he's just a ticket for them to get into heaven. But they've never submitted their lives to him as King. That's what it means to be a Christian. That's what it means. Have you submitted your life to him as King? Second of all, are you taking comfort in his role as your high priest? I want to tell you, there's nothing that you will go through, what you are going through, that Jesus Christ, because he identified with us, does not know about intimately. And not only that, not only does he know that, not only can he feel that and knows that intimately, but he is praying for you in the midst of that. Are you taking comfort in his role as your priest? And thirdly, are you on mission with your warrior Messiah? He doesn't want you to shelter yourself in the walls of the church or shelter yourselves in your community home or whatever. He wants you to be on mission with him in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your community, wherever it may be, on mission with him, taking ground from the devil, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, our great weapon. Are you on mission with him, following your warrior king? I want to pray. And then we're going to have a time of response. If you're here this morning, you just need to come. Maybe you just need to talk to me. You just need to come to the altars and pray. You just come. Let's pray. Father, we just pray this morning, Lord. We thank you for your word. Thank you, Father, for you, Lord, just giving us this Messiah, this Christ, King, Priest, Warrior. And Lord, we pray that we would embrace all those aspects of Jesus in our lives. and that for those who have not submitted their lives to Jesus would do so today. Submit to him as king. He is king. And one day he will rule. He's going to rule one way or the other. He will judge. And I pray that for those who have not made that surrender of their lives and embraced the cross, repenting of their sins and putting their faith in Christ alone for their salvation, would do so today. But for others that are here that know you, Lord, I pray that they would take comfort that he is their priest. And they also would be challenged that he is their warrior king for them to follow a mission. Let's pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand, please, and respond as God has spoken to your heart?
Stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he can love me, a sinner condemned unclean. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be.
Is my Savior's love for me.
Thank you so much. One of the tasks of a visiting pastor as a preacher is to make you desire to have yours come back. And so I hope I've accomplished that today. Looking at the time, I think I probably have. But thank you so much for the opportunity. Love this church. Love you. And I think we probably have some announcements. Somebody to close off. All right.
You can be seated real quick. So we got a couple announcements before we get out of here. But if you were blessed by that sermon, just make a sound of noise, a round of applause. Man, we want to say thank you, Wes, for that wonderful sermon. I know it touched my heart, and I hope that my heart wasn't the only one touched. But we'll get into our announcements. We have two things coming up. The first thing is that we have a bonfire coming up. It's the 29th of July. Put that in your calendars. It's going to be a great time. It's going to start at 5. Make sure to bring your lawn chairs. If you don't bring your lawn chair, we're just going to provide you a metal chair. That is not comfortable. Bring your lawn chairs, something comfortable. Well, that will be the 29th. Bring your lawn chairs. Once again, I told you 3 times, and you don't have a reason to forget now. And then the last thing is VBS. VBS is coming up. I have a couple tasks for you. If you are a part of VBS, start praying for the team. Start praying for yourself. Start praying over the material and looking it over. If you are not part of VBS, pray over the staff. Pray over the workers. VBS is just an amazing time to get out into our community. And sometimes we truly don't understand the impact that we can make in Hobart following the Lord in this process. So pray over the workers if you're not part of it. If you are part of it, start praying over your material and yourself. And then the last thing is, if you are part of VBS this year, we're going to have a quick 2-minute meeting. Quote me, 2 minutes, 2 minutes right after service. So I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then you're all dismissed. Our Heavenly Father, thank you. Sometimes we forget to say thank you for everything that you've done in our lives, that we are a church that is willing to serve the community, that we have VBS coming up. I pray over VBS, Lord, that we go into this with our hearts ready, expecting big things, not just hoping for big things, but because you are a great Lord, you are a warrior. We learn from this message that you will perform big things if we truly believe in the power and what we talk about and what we read about in the Bible. I pray that we leave here changed and that we just don't go into the world acting normal, but we take this message, hide it in our hearts, and we leave here to create an impact for you. I pray over this time, and I pray for the safety of everyone in here, and I ask this in your name we pray. Amen.